Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
During the summer, a long trial was conducted in Los Angeles, the implications of which are very much a matter of public interest. The plaintiff is Dr. Jeffrey McDonald, a convicted murderer serving three successive life terms. The defendant is Joe McGinniss, the well-known author. The complaint, the judge instructed the jury, was to be weighed without any reference to the documented murder by the defendant. His complaint was that McGinniss defrauded him by pretending to be sympathetic to his claims of innocence while engaged in writing his bestseller, Fatal Vision, in which McGinniss concurred with the jury's findings. The question, is a writer or a reporter risking a lawsuit if he gives the impression to the subject he is writing about that he is engaged in writing as an advocate? The jury deliberated for 5 days and did not reach a verdict. Pursuant to the protocols of full disclosure, I record that two professional writers gave testimony backing the McGinniss position. One was Joseph Wambo, the second me. Joe McGinniss is here with us for the first time since his appearance in connection with the publication of Fatal Vision. Mr. McGinniss grew up in Rye, New York, and was graduated from Holy Cross. He became then a writer and columnist for the Philadelphia Inquirer, wrote the bestseller, The Selling of the President, in 1969, and four more books before his fatal encounter with Jeffrey McDonald. He lives in Williamstown and teaches at Bennington College. Floyd Abrams is widely regarded as among the leading expert on the reaches of the First Amendment. He's with the law firm of Cahill Gordon, New York, and is a lecturer in law at Columbia University Law School. He graduated from Cornell and from the Yale Law School, where he subsequently served as a visiting lecturer. He has in the past dozen years received a dozen awards for his work on the First Amendment. It was he who pressed the Supreme Court and won the right to publish the Pentagon Papers in 1971. He is chairman of the Committee on Freedom of Speech and of the Press of the American Bar Association. Let's begin by letting our audience know what the jury in Los Angeles was told, namely something of the factual background of Mr. McGinniss's association with Dr. MacDonald. Accordingly, I shall ask Mr. McGinniss to reply briefly to a brief factual interrogatory. When did you meet Dr. MacDonald and under what circumstances?
I met him for the first time in June of 1979. Just a month prior to his trial for the murder of his wife and two children. And
what
the circumstances were that I was spending a brief period of time as a guest columnist with a Los Angeles newspaper, and I proposed to write a brief column on the plight of this man who had been accused first of these murders soon after they were committed back in 1970, and then had been honorably discharged by the Army, the charges having been dropped. And 9.5 years later, he was going to be brought back to North Carolina to stand trial as a civilian.
So you approached him or vice versa?
I approached him about doing a newspaper column.
What did he say?
He said yes about the column, and we had a three-hour meeting. At the conclusion of which, or toward the conclusion of which, he suggested that I might want to consider doing more than just a column, but perhaps a book about himself.
And you arrived at an agreement, the terms of which were what?
The agreement was essentially that in return for my having complete access to him and his lawyers throughout the trial and beyond, so I wouldn't have to sit in the audience. I would be able to be backstage watching them conduct their defense, attend all the meetings, etc., and have access to all of the documents which I otherwise would not be able to have access to, grand jury testimony, the military hearing transcripts, and in return for him, in addition, signing a release which gave me the power to write whatever I chose be it something that pleased him or displeased him. It was a specific document in which he waived his right to sue for libel, invasion of privacy, or anything else.
Was this an exchange supervised by a lawyer?
Yes, it was. In return for that, he was to receive a percentage of the proceeds from the book.
All right. Now, so then comes the trial. May I ask you this? At this point, had you any presuppositions about who was guilty and who was not? Did you think him innocent?
I had no idea. I simply didn't know any of the facts. I met him, spoke to him. I've said I was willing to presume innocence the way a juror would be instructed to, but that's a very different thing from going in believing in his innocence. I simply had no idea what happened. I didn't know any of the facts of the case.
Okay, so along comes the trial. He's found guilty, and you're writing away. But meanwhile, you are maintaining a very close personal association.
Certainly.
Now,
yes.
Did you instantly agree with the jury when it came to its findings?
Well, that is a difficult question to answer as briefly as you'd like me to, because there are degrees with which one agrees with something. There is, as the jury must find, guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, but then there's a notion of emotional doubt.
It's like both in the First Amendment, right?
On one level, yes. Right. On one level, I think I found that by the end of the trial, there was sufficient evidence so that the jury's finding didn't shock me or seem appalling. On the other hand, the very relationship that I had developed with him, he the subject and I the author, trying to understand him, to empathize with him as much as possible during the course of the trial, led me at that point to feel that this was the sort of man who simply couldn't have done this thing. And to put it simply, it was a conflict between what my head told me had to be true and what my heart told me couldn't be true.
So what were your relations with him after he was convicted?
We continued to correspond. He sent me a number of tape recordings for use in the book, which became Fatal Vision. After 11 months of incarceration, he was released on an appellate decision which found that his right to a speedy trial had been violated. Didn't overturn the jury verdict, but simply said that constitutionally his right to speedy trial had been violated. After 18 months of freedom, the Supreme Court reversed that, and he was reincarcerated.
During
all this time,
18 months, did you see him?
I saw him, I think, on two occasions.
And he knew you were hard at work writing the book?
Yes, he did.
And did he express curiosity about the conclusions you were reaching?
He would express curiosity, but he would continue to reconfirm through letters to me his awareness of the fact that I had complete freedom to reach any conclusions that I chose, that he had no, as he put it, artistic control over the book, that he had no right to see the manuscript before it was published or to in any way pass upon or approve its contents.
So at the end of 18 months, he's now back in jail. Is your book out at that point?
No. My book was not published until September of 1983.
Which was how far later?
Four years after the original conviction.
And so did you correspond with each other when he was back in jail?
We corresponded. The correspondence was most intensive in the first months after his conviction, when I was, in response to a variety of letters from him, was writing back letters which were very warm, supportive, and expressing compassion and sympathy for, which was quite genuine, for this human being. At the same time, my judgment was in the process of slowly forming itself and evolving in terms of.
Was there a point before the publication of the book at which he discovered that you had concluded that he was guilty?
I think the first time that he became fully aware, although we did have one telephone conversation in which he said to me that he wanted to be sure that my forthcoming book would be something he could use in a public relations campaign he was intending to mount. And I told him in that conversation that if I were him, I wouldn't count on the book as being an asset in such a campaign. Nonetheless, he has this sort of denial mechanism which does not permit him to absorb the sort of information he doesn't want to hear, and he was able to pass over that. I think the first time he understood fully what the book would say was when Mike Wallace went to do an interview with him for 60 Minutes 3 months prior to publication. Wallace had read the manuscript, went to interview him, and confronted him with the book's conclusions, which of course were no different from the conclusions of the jury or the appellate courts that reviewed the case.
So the book comes out, and then he files suit.
He files suit.
What
about
does he allege?
A year after the book was published, 11 months after. He alleged that the book contained numerous false statements of fact and implication, which damaged him. He alleged, he labeled the claims. Rather than labeling them libel, invasion of privacy, or the traditional things that, that authors get sued for, he labeled them rather creatively. He labeled them fraud, intentional infliction of emotional distress, breach of contract, breach of the covenant of good faith and fair dealing.
In which court?
In federal court in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed to me at that time from reading the complaint that essentially what he was trying to do was to circumvent the First Amendment protections that I would have as an author against a libel complaint. The primary one being that if what you publish is substantially true to begin with, well, then you're perfectly protected against a claim for libel.
He'd have been a public figure in the situation.
Absolutely. He had been seeking public attention for many, many years in regard to this.
Okay. Well, that probably reaches a point in which we can turn to Mr. Abrams and ask him this question. Ought the court, in your judgment, to have ruled that these complaints against Mr. McGinniss were simply a way of avoiding designating them as libel, which would instantly have given him certain protections which he otherwise didn't enjoy?
I think so. I think it's terribly important that courts not allow claims against authors, books, newspapers, or whatever, to be transformed out of First Amendment protected areas into ordinary non-First Amendment-like claims by just labeling them. As Mr. McGinniss says, for example, probably the greatest protection anyone has in a libel suit, and this has been true since the beginning of libel, at least in this country,
the truth
is that if what you say is true, you you can't be liable for what you say. You can't be responsible, even if it hurts. If what you say is true, the law favors you. It doesn't disfavor you. In this sort of suit, you have a bizarre reversal of that. In a sense, the truer what was said, the better the claim became.
Yeah.
Because the gravamen of the claim, after all, was that really here was an author who promised to write a favorable book, or inferred that he really liked Mr. McDonald.
Well, there's a big difference there. I think.
Well, he was saying both, was he not?
If in fact I read his papers. if I had promised to write a favorable book,
yes.
Which I would never do, he might have had
a
different degree of merit in that kind of a complaint. If for example,
you are part of the contract.
If you're Lee Iacocca and you hire me to tell your authorized biography, I extract all this information from you on that premise, and then I say, wait a minute, actually, I could do this much better if it's unauthorized, and I run across the street to another publisher, and I publish all these things that you had not expected to see, and you felt that you had the right of approval. That's a very different situation. Here we had the reverse, where not only did I maintain all my freedoms that I would have as an author without any documents being signed, but I went beyond that and had him sign releases on two separate occasions, which guaranteed me protection against suit for libel, invasion of privacy, or anything else by virtue of anything contained in the book. And to circumvent that, to circumvent the releases, he said the first one was signed under duress, even though his lawyer actually made an emendation to it. And the second one, he said he didn't consider carefully enough. And the judge found that the releases ought to be subject to the jury's scrutiny and the jury determination of whether or not they were legally binding. His claim was not that I had ever promised to write a book that portrayed him as innocent, which in the face of his conviction would have been to have perpetrated a fraud upon the reading public. If I wrote something, if I had a legal obligation to write something that I didn't believe to be true, I don't think it could be a binding contract even if it had existed. But it didn't exist. What I did was, quite genuinely, as a human being, display sympathy and compassion for a man as long as that was what I was feeling toward him. And when that point passed, so did the displays cease.
Well, let's get back for a second to the legal argument. As I understand it, your lawyer asked the court to reject his complaint on the grounds that he was simply concealing what was in effect a libel complaint. Let me ask Mr. Abrams this. If it had been a libel complaint, could he have counted on his being dismissed right away?
Well, I assume so, in light of the conviction. For one thing, it seems to me that Mr. McDonald is what we call libel-proof. Mm-hmm. There aren't many people that are libel-proof, but a person who's been convicted of murdering his wife and children, mm-hmm. More than anyone that this body of law has been applied to, I don't think would be heard in court to say, oh, but you got this detail wrong about it, or you got that wrong. So I think on that ground, and on truth.
You could say he was a member of the mafia and still.
Yes, because that's less bad than what he did.
Right.
So I don't think there's any way he could have had a libel suit.
So therefore, a great deal hinges, given what subsequently happened, on the judge's refusal to see through this synthetic smokescreen of McDonald.
Well, I think so. And this is something, let me say, which has been happening more and more often as smart lawyers representing people who sue try by a process of labeling a claim not liable, labeling it not invasion of privacy, to avoid what the courts have held are the enormous protections of the First Amendment. The U.S. Supreme Court has such a case before it now, which was brought by Mr. Falwell against Larry Flint, with respect to some very offensive and nasty cartoon-like characterizations of Reverend Falwell. The jury in that case said, look, it's not libelous because no one could believe it. Mm-hmm. And it's not an invasion of privacy just because it's not. But it is intentional infliction of emotional injury. And that's one of the things that they claimed against you.
Yes.
And if you can just end run First Amendment protections by calling a claim something else, the protections really aren't worth a lot.
And if you call it emotional distress, it's especially interesting, I think, because if the truth hurts, under the theory advanced by McDonald, one would be precluded from publishing it if one had the awareness in advance that the truth would hurt. And this seems to me to be a radical incursion upon ground that had previously been protected by the First Amendment.
Well, presumably the jury's findings also hurt, didn't they?
The jury's findings?
Also hurt McDonald.
The jury's findings in North Carolina.
Yes. Well, I would presume that the greater emotional distress would have been suffered when he found the jury had convicted him.
So anything you did would be supererogatory.
I would tend to think so. I'm not responsible for him being incarcerated then for the rest of his life.
No.
But interestingly, this question of labeling came up twice in this case, because when the suit was filed, my publishing company turned to its insurance company, and we have this insurance that protects authors in case of lawsuit. And the insurance company said, no, we're not going to cover this or pay for it because it doesn't say libel, and that's what we insure against. And I was forced eventually to go to federal court in New York and seek a declaratory judgment, which I did receive from a judge who said that we must pierce the labels and get down to the essence. In other words, if you see a coat hanging on a rack, but somebody puts a label on it that says hat, mm-hmm. you can still recognize it as being a coat. Mm-hmm. And you just peel off that label that says hat, and you put it on, you wear it as a coat. Well, this is a coat. This is essentially a libel suit. If the content of my book were different, if I had concluded that Jeffrey McDonald was not guilty of these crimes, he wouldn't be suing me. He's suing me for what the book said about him. Mm-hmm. But because, as Mr. Abrams points out, he can't do it in the traditional way, he circumvents it by saying, well, I'm not really suing him so much for that as for the way he made me think it was going to say something else.
So, in effect, you have at this point a federal judge ruling that the true meaning of this complaint is something that should entitle you to protection under the libel law, while the trial judge out in California had declined to rule on that basis. However, since he was in charge of the case, it then went to the jury. And what happened?
Well, after these days of deliberation, the jury expressed the view that they were hopelessly, not even deadlocked so much as confused, and were not going to be able to render a verdict on any one of the 37 questions. They weren't just asked to decide whether or not the book hurt McDonald's feelings. There were no sort of simple instructions given to them in that regard. There was a special verdict form which had 37 different boxes to check off yes or no, And it became apparent that they simply didn't understand how the facts that had been presented at trial related to the questions that, that they had in front of them. And after 3 days, they announced that they were unable to really agree upon anything and asked to be allowed to go home.
Was your lawyer, well, you can ask me, if you had been the judge, would you have permitted Ms. McGinniss's lawyer to communicate to the jury that this was really a libel complaint? Or would that have been scornful of your judgment?
Well, yes, I think not. If I were a judge and thought that the case should proceed to the jury, mm-hmm. implicit in that judgment is my judgment that it's not a liable case. And so I would
this would be a matter of law, not a fact?
It would be a question of law as to what it is. Now, I certainly wouldn't keep a lawyer from arguing to a jury all sorts of things about Dr. McDonald, including that he committed the crime.
Yeah.
Well, one of the startling things to me is that, you know, here you have someone who a jury has found committed this most heinous of all acts, and you still had people on a jury that listened, I gather, am I right? Listened with great interest, maybe sympathy, willingness to treat him like everyone else. Maybe a jury's supposed to do that, but it's pretty unusual when you have a murderer in front of you.
As one of them put it to me afterward, we were permitted and indeed encouraged to speak to the jurors after their non-verdict was reached.
Including Dr. McDonald?
No, he wasn't. His lawyers were, but he himself was reincarcerated at that time. He was present during the trial and was in court all day, dressed like this in suits and no handcuffs on, you know, during the in the presence of the jury, which was like a summer vacation for him. It was great, you know, to get out of jail. But at the end, one of the jurors said to me, the fact, Mr. McGinniss, is that it wasn't McDonald who was on trial here, it was you. You were the defendant. You were the one we had to judge. And another one said something else, which I found rather chilling, if interesting, and that was that we felt there must have been something wrong here, or else the judge would not have permitted it to get this far.
Yes.
Well, that's a presumption of guilt rather than a presumption of innocence.
That's another problem, and it happens a lot in libel cases. Indeed, it happens, a lot of lawyers would argue, in almost all civil cases. As you get a trial going for 5 or 6 weeks, there will be jurors that think they wouldn't have been there, but for the fact that something bad happened, that the system is not created.
There must
created.
Be fire there somewhere.
Yes, and I can understand a juror thinking wrongly in a case like this. If this case is here, there must be something to it.
And that's why, isn't it, the Supreme Court has actually urged judges to grant summary judgment in libel cases, because the real chilling effect, I mean, the real damage comes not necessarily with an unfavorable verdict, although of course that's worse, but the very fact of having to endure the trial, the time, the expense, I mean, these are things which would cause one to think twice before exercising one's First Amendment rights. And
surely for an individual author, wouldn't you think, for an individual author, even more perhaps than a journalist employed by a large newspaper?
Sure.
What are you going to do next?
I mean, I had 8 weeks of my working time were taken away from me, and when I was not compensated, at the very least, and that's the least of it. But if you are employed by a large newspaper or magazine or network, and you're sued, I believe in most cases, if not all, your salary you continue to get paid. Mm-hmm. I didn't get paid. You know, my time is as a lawyer's time is precious to me. And there's no salary involved, so that's a deleterious effect right there. Moreover, I think the Supreme Court has encouraged judges to grant summary judgment because of the complexity of this kind of litigation. This case went on as long as the original criminal case. It took 6.5 weeks of trial for McDonald to be convicted of the murders. We were out there for 6.5 weeks with him trying to prove that I had hurt his feelings, mm-hmm. and. The disproportion there, or the lack of disproportion, seems.
Well, this would certainly suggest a dereliction on the part of the judge. That is to say, if I understand your analysis and that of Mr. Abrams, it is to prevent such situations that judges are given such powers. Now, what would the people who disagree with you, Mr. Abrams, on this point object in that generality?
What they would say is...
It's a factual question.
Exactly. That they would say the meaning of this release is factual. There's language in the release about how you were, what, supposed to preserve the integrity of his character in some sort of way. They would say, as they did, look, this wasn't a libel case at all. This was someone you misled. I can mislead someone. People in the audience here can mislead someone. And if you mislead him badly enough, you ought to have a right to go to court.
But how would they handle your argument that misleading gets lost under the pressure of the larger judgment? How would they handle that? That's the judge's business to decide?
Yeah, I mean, that's the basic legal issue as to whether you can so dissect all these things as to say that misleading someone about writing a book about him is something entirely different from what the book says about him.
It really tries to divide the creative process into these two distinct phases, which really are not distinct.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the other things that occurs to me as you question, Mr. Buckley, one of the things about libel cases in general, which are troublesome, is this inquiry into the state of mind of journalists. It comes with the territory because libel law in America is very favorable to journalists. But one of the price tags of that is that a lot of questions come about what did you know and when did you know it. Here, without benefit of any of the First Amendment protections, you're on the stand, I take it, being asked again and again, what did you know? When did you know this? What were you thinking when you wrote that?
That was the central question.
Let me ask this, Mr. Abrams. Suppose he had said, responding truthfully in all matters, I absolutely knew he was guilty on the 1st of April, 1975, but I continued to let him think that I thought he was innocent for 2 years.
Yes.
Would that have justified a finding for the plaintiff?
I don't believe so. I really don't. I mean, that raises a nice issue of the difference between the sort of situations which law ought to deal with and the sort of situations as to which we may pass a moral judgment on somebody, but which law as such is not designed to deal. We have all sorts of situations like that.
Well, you've had a lot of dealings with the press. Was I incorrect in testifying as I did that a writer, especially an investigative writer, very often gives an impression intending to disarm the person he's writing about? Does that shock you ethically or in any other sense?
No, it doesn't. But I will tell you, having interviewed a lot of jurors, that any sort of action by journalists which misleads people in the journalistic process is something that a lot of ordinary citizens, non-lawyers, non-journalists, find very offensive.
So therefore they need instruction about the legal carriage.
That's right. And it's very important that the law be clear. I think we perhaps are too harsh on the judge here. I don't know of another case which has been brought which alleged just what was alleged here. So at least as I view it, it's a case of first impression. And although I think the judge erred, I think that for the future, what we need are still clearer rules to keep cases like this out of the courts.
Well, are you saying then that there is no case law involving a journalist or an author who flat out deceived who he was writing about in order to get from him information that he wouldn't otherwise have got?
That's correct. I don't know of any case in which that was the basis of a claim. That's right.
Of a claim. Now, would that suggest that any claim lodged probably was overwhelmed by superior legal questions, as should have been the case here, or just it's never come up?
No, it would suggest, lawyers are creative enough, so that what that would suggest to me is that the claim probably lacks merit, that it probably is submerged within the greater whole of a libel case and should be viewed as submerged within the greater whole of a libel case.
Let me ask you this factual question, Ms. McGinniss, in the light of what Mr. Abrams said about how jurors tend to react. Did the plaintiff's attorney, Dr. MacDonald's attorney, read aloud to the jury from some of the letters that you wrote to Dr. MacDonald?
Oh, he did more than that. He would extract paragraphs from them and blow them up on a big screen and let the jurors read along with him.
And were there any that retroactively embarrassed you?
Oh, embarrassed me, sure, because I felt terribly embarrassed at how I could have been so completely taken in by this man. this man had been, I was very embarrassed.
I was talking about disingenuous letters.
No, I was embarrassed by the genuineness of them, not the disingenuousness of them. The fact that I could have felt such sympathy for someone who I later came to recognize was so undeserving of it was embarrassing to me. I felt gullible, I felt taken in, I felt like a bit of a fool.
Well, were any of the letters that he blew up letters that were written by you at a time when the jurors had been shown you actually had concluded that the jury was right in convicting him?
Well, the jurors had been shown newspaper interviews in which I had made statements to the effect that, and they would vary from interview to interview, and there were three or four of them among 100 or so that I did when the book was published. The question would be, when did you first decide that McDonald was guilty? And this was an obvious question that you're asked over and over again. Six or seven times a day. Would you answer it as you did here?
I would
answer it in various ways, because sometimes you get tired of hearing yourself say the same thing over and over again. And I, at some times, would answer it by saying, well, I first had some problems. I first began to doubt. I felt uneasy at certain points. And then there were times when I said, if I had been, one or two occasions, I flatly said, if I had been a juror, I would have probably or almost certainly voted to have convicted I myself would have voted to convict him. That was the basis for the claim that any expressions of sympathy
were hypocritical.
That they were hypocritical, that I didn't really believe what I was writing in those letters, that they were a snow job, a sort of lead to lead him on.
Well, talking now about the human factor, which interests us professionally, I remember a couple of days ago, Judge Bork was asked, at what point did you come to believe that the 14th Amendment's protections extended to women? And his expression really communicated his contempt for the question. There wasn't a moment. There wasn't an epiphany,
right?
And that was true with you. Now, that's something a jury can understand, right? At what moment do you decide you want to divorce your husband? Most of them probably would not be able to fix that moment.
That's true. The problem comes, though. It came for Judge Bork, and I don't know if it came for you. When there's a written record where somebody has taken a position at a particular moment. And said at a particular time, I believe such and such is the law, or perhaps in your case, I'm sympathetic to you. I haven't read the letters.
That could be human charity.
Sorry for you. But that could indeed be only human charity.
Yeah.
The interesting question for me on a moral level is suppose the jury did conclude that you were misleading him.
Yeah.
Now,
that's not a legal case, is it?
I don't think so. I mean, we'd have mighty crowded courts.
If you allege fraud, you also, I believe, have to find some sort of damage.
Yes.
And the question here has always been, among others, just in the bottom line legally, how was he damaged by this alleged fraud?
Having already been convicted of murder.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, surely this cries out for instruction by the judge, does it not? Doesn't the judge have to say to the... Did any juror say to the judge, look, judge, tell me, are we supposed to be against him if we believe that he gave the defendant grounds for thinking that he was innocent when actually he had concluded that he was guilty? Did anybody ask the judge that question?
Not to my knowledge, no.
Yeah. One of the problems, too, how long did the jury charge take? How many minutes, hours?
It, I suppose, was a matter of a couple of hours, and then there were these 65 or so pages of printed instructions.
See, that's really hard, and that's not the judge's fault. In order to get all the law out, you have to explain it, and you have to put all the nuances in. One may say this shouldn't have gone to the jury in the first place. One may say juries just shouldn't be put to the task of waiting through hours of lawyer talk, however reasonably it's phrased, however well it's phrased. But I think you really have to be, you know, once you say that cases like this will go to juries, you will have 65 pages read to the jury.
Who says A
over
must say
some
B?
Hours.
Yeah, it's a situation in which if the judge has ruled that it belongs in the hands of the jury, then he's pre-committed to the notion that if the jury finds there was fraud, never mind that there was no damage caused by it, then the defendant is guilty. Is that right?
If that's what the judge has said. My problem...
Well, didn't he say it implicitly by authorizing the case to proceed?
implicitly he did. I assume on the fraud count, he said something about damages.
That was one of the five criteria that would have to be met, and the jury didn't find that.
It comes at the end of the first hour in a charge to a lay jury, which is trying its best, and the judge is reading from a difficult to read and still more difficult to understand body of legal verbiage, and a jury at its best struggling to comprehend this can't do it. There are five elements of this and two elements of that. You must find this. You need not find that. You should take into account. Yeah. It's impossible.
Well, let me ask you this, which is really quite apart from our interest in the particular case, an aspect of our general interest in its implications. Assuming that the trial were to go back to another jury, and that jury were to find against Mr. McGinniss, in your judgment, this would have what effects on the profession whose rights you are professionally identified with protecting?
I think it would interfere considerably with the news gathering process in situations quite far afield from yours,
sure.
Joe. I think that it's routine for journalists to talk to subjects. It's routine for the subjects to be unhappy later on about what was written about them, for one reason or another. And particularly when the subject does not have a good libel case, it would be terribly tempting for someone written about to say, look, I wouldn't have told you those things if you hadn't let me think that I was going to come out looking pretty good.
Well, for instance, Charlotte Curtis and Leonard Bernstein, wouldn't that be an example? Leonard Bernstein gives a party for Black Panthers. Charlotte Curtis is invited to the party. She comes out the next day with a blistering account of what happened, including all kinds of things that Leonard Bernstein said to her, which he would not have said to her, obviously, if he thought that she was going to write the next day this particular piece in the New York Times, which was a very important piece of journalism, by the way.
Tom Wolfe did a whole book about the Black Panther party.
Then Tom Wolfe, of course.
Same kind of thing.
Of course, he didn't speak to anybody there.
But he listened.
He listened, yeah.
I think another case in point here would be Bob Woodward's book about John Belushi, where he went to Belushi's widow, Mrs. Belushi, and said, as I understand it, you know, I'm interested in writing a book, but I want to capture the whole man. I want to, you know, whatever he said, I don't know specifically what he said, but she said, when the book came out, I feel terribly cheated. I feel misled. Woodward came to me and he said, he appeared sympathetic. I thought he was going to write a book which would have portrayed my husband in a better light than that which he did portray.
I represented him in her lawsuit.
And, oh, you did?
And one of the things that she said out of court, not in the lawsuit, was he didn't tell the good side about drugs. And she made it very clear that she really expected this to be a sympathetic, sort of warm, embracing biography of her former husband.
And Woodward did nothing to disabuse her of that expectation.
You got Alger Hiss and Alan Weinstein.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Now maybe there you've got a situation comparable to Mr. McGinniss's in that he had been convicted. He might have said, at least the defense of Weinstein might have said, he having been convicted, there's no way in which you can damage him by anything said in this book beyond the fact of his having been convicted, right? However, presumably he might have lodged some sort of lawsuit, right?
Under
the McGinniss precedent.
This theory, yes, which I hope does not become precedent.
Yeah.
I mean, how often are people really happy with what's written about them? And how often are they happy when anything worth writing is written about them? If we allow lawsuits in situations in which people say, look, I just wouldn't have talked to you, Mr. Buckley.
No,
I was going to come out well.
Well, let me ask you this. Was there an implicit contract between Charlotte Curtis and Leonard Bernstein when she talked to him? Because we do have a contract here.
Well, we have a contract.
And release.
The contract, see, actually, I think, if anything, would move strongly in my favor. This was a release. This was not a contract in which I obliged myself to perform any functions for McDonald that I was not otherwise obliged to perform. Quite the contrary. He signed the release absolving me from any possible fear of future litigation. One paragraph of that release was modified in one sentence to say that I will not, it originally read along the lines of, I will not sue for defamation. His lawyer added a handwritten notation that said, as long as the essential integrity of my life story is maintained, whatever that means.
Was operative weight given to that by the judge?
Yes, indeed.
If it hadn't been for that sentence, there wouldn't have been a case?
The judge felt that that somehow had created an affirmative obligation on my part to write a book which McDonald would view as maintaining the essential integrity of his life.
How would you have handled that problem?
Well, first I would say that the language used had nothing to do with what McDonald would view. It simply said to maintain the essential integrity of his life. The integrity of his life is that he's a murderer.
That's a fact.
You know, I was thinking of Truman Capote's book, Answered Prayers.
Oh, boy.
And all the women he dined with around this city who thought that they were talking to him as a buddy, as a luncheon friend. And he was
That's right. Now, they had sanctions at their disposal, which they used.
Indeed.
Those were terminated friendships.
Yes, social sanctions.
That's right.
Yes.
And but these sanctions are different from legal sanctions.
Yeah, suppose he were alive.
Yeah.
And one of the people referred to in the book sued.
Everybody knows that they mean me.
Yes, everybody knows it's me. And I never would have told you these things if I ever thought you were going to do a book on it.
Well, of course, they might have had a libel case if, in fact, it were an identifiable character and if it was false.
Libel, yes, but the question of a McGinniss, if you'll forgive me, lawsuit, as to whether somebody could have said, I wouldn't have spoken to you if I hadn't thought that you'd take care of me by not mentioning me.
Yes, or by a favorable portrayal. At what point does the expression of sympathy for someone's human condition constitute a waiver of the author's right to later portray that individual accurately according to the author's own lights, by the author's sole discretion?
Let me give you an example, if I may, Mr. Abrams, of a representation I made to the jury when I was asked by the attorney for the plaintiff to give an example of the kind of thing I meant. So I said, well, look, suppose I was a writer and I was writing a book about Alan Cranston, Senator, and I came to suspect that he was a bigamist. He had a lady in Florida that he was married to also. And he turned to me at some point in his ruminative conversations and said, Bill, this friend of mine I have in Florida, you don't suspect there's anything between us, do you? And I said, oh, no. Now, this would be a stratagem if I said, oh, no. In fact, I did. And this is a stratagem which I think is a part of the authorized armature inventory of the profession. Now, I have two questions. Number one, do you agree with me? Number two, is this the kind of thing that would have put off a jury?
Yes. My answer, first, I agree with you that it is routine behavior. Second, let me say, I think it should not be the basis of a lawsuit under any circumstances. But third, yes, juries get very offended by that. And as portrayed in court, it becomes more than a line. It becomes a board, a cardboard board with the words enormously heightened in impact by being written out and underlined and a quotation marks around them.
Well, if they don't like it, doesn't really mean that they oughtn't to accept it. That is to say, the role of a professional witness is to say what, in fact, are the standards and the operating procedures in his own profession, right?
Yes.
Now, if a lawyer or if say a car salesman were to come and say, "Well, do you check whether that woman has insurance before you sell her a car?" He says, "Yes." The jury might not like it, but they're obliged to accept it as a modus operandi in that profession, aren't they?
That's true. But what a jury would do if it were offended enough at a used car salesman
is rebuke him because
of
this.
This happened here. In closing argument, McDonald's lawyer referred back to Mr. Buckley's testimony, and he said, well, you remember Mr. Buckley said he couldn't quite tell you what a lie was. Well, my mother could have told him what a lie was.
Yeah.
And that kind of simplistic
sounds
appealing...
Sounds like all inspector versus
that,
book.
Well, that's your analogy. In the end, the jury seemed to be saying that even if this is commonly accepted standard operating procedure, it ought not to be Now, the question is, do they have legal authority
to
alter 200 years of standard operating procedure because six of them don't happen to think that that's the way things should be. Even in this case...
You should have said to Senator Cranston, now look, I happen to know, level with me.
Worse than this, you would have to say to Senator Cranston at the beginning of every encounter you had with him, now, Senator, I must remind you again that even though I may appear to be sympathetic to you, I am in no way bound by that and what I might
write. And I've already concluded you're a bigamist and a cheat and an adulterer.
You would have to give him a Miranda warning before every encounter. There's a problem, really, of lack of awareness of how books, articles, newspaper stories are put together. The judge in this case actually expressed the view during an oral argument for summary judgment that it was his impression, which I believe you later helped to correct through your testimony, that it was common practice for the subjects of books to get to read the manuscript in advance. Mm-hmm. And that it was somehow a deviation from what was common practice for me not to have shown this to him. Now, this is not malevolence on the part of the judge. This is just simply a lack of awareness of what is standard operating procedure.
Right.
Another example here was my character was assailed by McDonald's lawyer because I had not met the deadline in my publishing contract for having finished the manuscript. The book was overdue. I got an extension. I was still working. I got another extension. You know, the book was overdue.
Did you go to the Smithsonian to find out an author who had met his deadline?
Well, that's we had a witness, an editor from New York, testify that in her experience, no nonfiction author, not to mention novelist, had ever delivered a book on time. But this was used as evidence of my bad character.
This is why we have capital punishment.
That's right. And McGinniss broke his promise to McDonald. He broke his promise to his publisher.
But in your conversations with the jurors, did you establish that they were affected by this?
I think that they felt that this was all part of a...
kind of an unreliable guy.
Yes. You can't. His word means nothing. He tells his publisher September 30th, and here it is November, and
should a judge handle a situation like that?
He's got to take it away from the jury. I mean, the only way to really handle it is not to let cases like this go to the jury.
He can't keep correcting the jury as these things happen.
You know? One of the reasons is that jurors are, in a sense, the conscience of a community. Now, that has good things about it. When juries in certain types of cases make it clear that they won't stand for faulty automobiles, for example, it makes for better cars, safer cars. Problem is, if you set a jury which doesn't have any background in an area like this, sort of free to go do good, and they come upon something that they think isn't right, they think you shouldn't let someone think that you're going to write something good about them when you're not, they could do terrible things to not just to their profession of journalism, but to their ability ever to get any news.
Yes.
Well,
yes.
Given the gravity that you attach to this and its implications, would you guess that if McGinniss lost next time around, a higher court would kill it?
Well, I do guess that, yes. I think so. I think this is a case which has such enormous potential for changing all the ground rules for journalism, not just books.
Right.
Not just books with a subject where you have an arrangement with of the sort that you did, but the entire news gathering process.
Well, now,
That's why we had approached the judge with the possibility of appealing his denial of summary judgment even prior to trial.
Can you do that?
You can, if he certifies.
Yes,
and
he
did not choose to certify.
What does that mean?
He has to agree to allow the case to be heard by an appellate court before the jury hears it.
It's up to him?
It's up to him. Ordinarily, you can't. It's called an interlocutory appeal. And ordinarily, the judge would say, as I guess he did say here, look, we'll send it to the jury first, and if I'm wrong, then you can appeal.
Yes.
The problem with that, A, is that if you win the case, there'll never be an appeal from your side about having to try it in the first place.
Right.
B, you have to go through a lengthy trial. And see, in the meantime, everything changes.
Yes.
The whole rules of the game are changed.
So has that point been reached? Has he agreed to have his judgment appealed?
No, he did not before the trial. Now there's been this lengthy trial, which resulted in a mistrial. And now we go back to the judge with a renewed motion to dismiss. And on new grounds that grew out of the actual trial testimony. So it's not just reiterating the same arguments, but now we have new facts to attach to them. And again, should he not choose to dismiss all counts himself, he would have the authority to grant us the right to forestall a second lengthy and confusing trial, which is very likely to result in the same sort of non-verdict.
Because these issues, by going to the Court of Appeals?
Yes, yes.
Can you give the audience a dollar figure on this litigation? Because I think for empirical reasons, people would be interested in that.
Sure. Well, the cost, my best estimate of the cost to date, just for my own defense, has been approximately $300,000.
And what would be the cost to the other side? Less, obviously, but.
Well, less because it's in California. I had to live in a hotel in Los Angeles for 49 days and nights.
With your lawyers, yeah.
And witnesses had to be flown in from. But it's not insubstantial. And the cost to taxpayers, which is something that's often overlooked, I've been told it's about $10,000 a day to conduct business in a federal courtroom.
You mean just salaries to court employees?
Everything, all put together. The whole works, $10,000 a day.
Sounds awfully high.
Well, Mr. Abrams would know better than I, but if we...
I'm still marveling at how you got off as cheap at $300,000.
Well, that's because you weren't his lawyer.
Too true,
I have a public-spirited attorney willing to work
So what we're talking, in other words, over $500,000.
Oh, yes, yes.
Plus the value of your time.
Well, there's that.
Well, sure, there's that, which tends to be... go uncounted in all of these situations.
There's also, I think, a sort of generalized intimidating effect. Maybe Mr. McGinniss isn't intimidated or chilled or whatever we call it.
Well, I bet his publishers are, though.
But the publishing, the book publishing industry is not known as the most militant in defending First Amendment rights. I mean, they do what they have to do. Sometimes, but it doesn't come easy. They don't make a lot of profit on most books. They lose money on a lot of books. It hurts them, and they think it hurts them, to go through lengthy trials. Insurance rates go up even if you win.
Sure, that's what's happened here.
So I could easily imagine any publisher, any honorable publisher, changing that publisher's behavior.
Just not wanting to have books published.
What is easier than to say to the next Joe McGinniss that comes along with an idea like this, look, it's a good book, it's just not for us.
That's right.
I'm sure there are a lot of places they'd be glad to handle it. We don't really need that.
I think that's already happening. I think publishers are choosing not to proceed with books for fear of litigation. And moreover, when books are written, true stories being told about living people that may displease the subject. These manuscripts are now more routinely being turned over not just to the publishing company lawyers for libel review, but now to lawyers from the insurance companies. Mm-hmm. So you wind up with insurance company lawyers dictating what can and cannot be published. Mm-hmm. And that does not seem to advance the cause of the First Amendment. The whole genre of telling true stories about living people, which is I think relatively recent origin, at least in modern times, seems to me to be threatened by this kind of an approach. If you could always rely upon a libel defense that said, if what I write is true, I'm protected, that was one thing. There were still problems, there's lots of libel cases, but now you're going far, far beyond that to say, even if what I write is true, I'm not protected. In fact, I might not be protected precisely because what I have written is true. Mm-hmm. This is going to make it, I mean, Joseph Wambau did testify, and I know he meant it because he's told me this off the stand, not on oath, privately. He's simply not going to write nonfiction anymore. He's written 3 of his 7 books have been nonfiction books. He's finished with that genre. He's just not going back to it. Too much risk.
Let me ask you this. Does the American Bar Association ever file a brief, a Mickey Curiae, on subjects of this kind?
Very rarely. It would only be only at the Supreme Court level, first of all, and very rarely even there. There are organizations.
You head their freedom of speech committee.
I used to head that, and they do amicus curiae briefs. I resigned from their amicus curiae committee some years ago, and I thought they weren't doing good amicus curiae briefs. But it would take some doing to get them to do it here. Here, more likely, I would say
they would be complacent. It would be knocked off upstairs.
I would like to think that the publishing industry would rally behind you, starting with the book publishing industry, but extending far beyond that, and hopefully a lot of other entities that care about values like
these. Well, you know, Penn has, the Authors Guild have, but the publishing industry, I must say, has been slow to perceive the threat, if that's what
it is. It's interesting to me that this threat should occur in of all the suits one could imagine, a suit by a murderer. It's hard to believe that a suit by a convicted murderer is
Charles Manson filed for a libel.
Yes, or Manson filed a jaywalking claim or something.
Why wouldn't the insurance companies, wouldn't they be the logical people alongside the publishers to finance a brief amicus curiae?
Well, I would think that there would be briefs, amicus curiae. Let me say, it's pretty unusual to have these briefs at the district court, at the lowest court level.
So if he lost, that's when they would flow
in. Yes, I think they would start in the Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit,
right,
if you were to lose in the California Federal Court. And surely you'd have a lot of support. I don't wish it upon you, but surely you'd have a lot of support if you had to go all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Thank you very much, Mr. Joe McGinniss, Mr. Floyd Abrams, ladies and gentlemen from Saints Cosmas and Damien Human Service Center.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content.